Okay, so now we have seen that how this particular integer, I mean, how we can convert numbers within the string, you know, in a numeric form. Again, this is how you can say that is a parse and static method in integer class. And see, these are all like utility methods. You will definitely, though we are not going to, do a lot of Java in our MapReduce, you know, or any within Hadoop, basically, when you go to Hadoop. But still, I mean, there are methods, there are classes that you can easily, you know, get a lot of utility methods that you can use, you know, on the fly. So this is in this is what is an integer example we were discussing about TypeSave, that is over here. And what we are doing over here now is we will try to convert each of them, since we have numbers also. Or let me just, you know, put them over like this. Let me try to use this list class to be the list of strings. And those strings may have numbers in it, and I want, or like what we are expecting basically is that all the members or all the members of this list are having a string, and those strings are mandatorily have the numbers in it. That's what we are expecting. Okay, but then we know that there is some glitch over here, and we see that this is not something integer, right? This is not something not integer. Not integer, but let's say these values we are getting at the runtime. We never know that what values can come at the runtime that we may need to convert it into integer. Okay, now for each of these elements, what we are going to do is basically we are going to convert them integer I equals to new. Sorry, not integer dot. Why don't we create object over here? Because it is a static method we are actually using out of it, right? So when I say parse is, so it is coming as a static method, okay? And for using a static method, we need not to create the object, and we just call the static method directly from the class level, and that's why there is no new keyword we are using. Okay, so just I'm trying to let you remember the fundamentals. Okay, don't make it wash out of your mind. We are not using new keyword, we are not making object, we are just using the parse and static method directly from the class level, and we are going to pass this s to be I. Basically it should be list dot get. This is the thing we are getting from the thing. So list dot get is it is pointing to this. Get means we are actually getting out the element out of it, just like inserting the, you know, values into array and then reading it back. That is what we are doing. So we are inserting over here, now reading it back. So we are now trying to convert it into int dot parse int. Okay, and then and we need to I dot to string I. Now it says duplicate row called variable. So let me say e. Not I, sorry, either here. So I, we cannot, I specifically I over here. So I is, again, I mean, I is, this variable is also for loop. We cannot use the same again over here. So I just change the name of variable. What it says now, the meta parse and string in the integer is not applicable for arguments of objects. So I am just converting this to a string. Okay, now this particular is the parameter to this parse int. Okay, and this is in terms of to string. And now this is where we now convert the equivalent of this thing to two string. So two string is just it will just try to convert the object to its string representation. Okay, we will see that later more in depth, but this is now a first occurrence we have used two string in order to convert the, because this is what we are trying to get is the object, right? List.get, and whenever I give the index of that, it will return me the object of at that place, at that particular, you know, index. So this is zero index, this is first index, this is second index. Okay, so we will loop it through, and now we will try to sys o every time we will get, let's print it. Okay, now let me run this example. TypeSave. So it gives me one on the first iteration over here, because it could convert this one perfectly in this thing, in this particular calculation, and it showed me like that. But when it comes to the second iteration and name, name cannot be converted into because it does not have a number in it, right? It does not have a number, and that's why we got this error. Okay, again, it's a number format exception. So what happens is basically, till Java 1.5, list can have any kind of objects into it. Either it would be an integer object or a string object or double object, triple object, whatever objects are there. Then basically, if you try to run any operation just by thinking that that particular list is having that type of objects only, and you are just assuming it and try to run that a particular calculation on it, you will definitely get a runtime error that you cannot stop. Okay, you cannot get rid of it. So what Java did is basically prior to Java 1.5, this was the problem. But when Java 1.5 got introduced, they have introduced a concept of called generics. Okay, Java generics, where we can now tell that this list will always hold a kind of objects. Okay, so I know that these are a string, right? And I just want to have them to have only integer types. So what I will do is basically I will just check it. Okay, so one we can not put over here, so this is all okay. Let me just rename it. So it's still the same error. So this first element is integer element. Second element is of string type, and third element is of again integer type, right? So we are having the mixture of the types of object in this list collection, and we are trying to do this operation on each of that element. So we are just getting it, converting it in, get its integer part and try to print it. So since this is integer, we easily get its integer output, no issues. This is a string. We are trying to convert that string, whether it is having number or not, or it should have all the numbers, then it would be okay. So if I make it 100, then it should be running. I mean, why? Because this particular operation can easily convert this string to be in a number. Okay, so if I run Java application, it all good, right? But then if I put name, that it was giving a problem. So in Java 1.5, basically what they introduced, they will let this list know that it can hold only this kind of object. So either you can put only integers can come over here, and this array list also you need to put a diamond bracket and put only integers. So as soon as you do this, this element automatically comes in error. Okay, so you cannot add this. And now if you run this type safe, it will run without any error, because this cannot be inserted at all when you define that what kind of objects can go into the thing. So this is what is called this diamond bracket over here. This diamond brackets are basically the way in which we are dealing, or we are telling this list object that what objects it can hold, is called Java generics. Diamond brackets tell you that it is Java generics. So 2-3 concepts we have gone through in this simple code. One is how we can, first of all, the things are getting auto boxed. Okay, over here, as soon as we give primitive data type, it will be auto boxed into its corresponding class, get packaged into the list and assign an index to it. When we read it back and we want to treat this list not to be the list of the collection of variety of objects, we want to treat this list to be hold only the single type of object, then we need to use this generic call. Okay, over here. So either you can have the list of integer, or you can have the list of a string, you can have the list of double, or you can have a list of float. You should not have it combined. No, you should not allow more than one type of object when you are trying to create the list. This is the safest way of doing programming, so that you will avoid the runtime exceptions. Okay, that we get. Okay, so this is what is called, auto boxing as well Java generics. So Java generics, and this you will see heavily in Hadoop MapReduce. Okay, look, most of the code will have this kind of diamond bracket. Inside that diamond bracket, you will get a class over there, and it will tell you that only that kind of class can have. Okay, so all the collection will support this Java generics. Not only list, map also will support this. So map will tell you that what kind of key and what kind of value you can have, or what kind of class, or what kind of key class and what kind of value class you will have in the map. Okay, so that also we will see. So this is clear, right? Auto boxing is done, Java generics is done. Now let's go further. Now let's try to create one student object. What it is type already exists. So we can use this one. It's already created, so let me. And I will have only integer, I will say roll number, and then its name. I don't want to have the school. Okay. What I will do is, let me define one constructor for this student class, and that constructor is public. Let me define it over here. Public student. It will accept the parameter of int roll and string name. Then it will just this dot roll number equals to roll. We can put a super call in front of it. Then this dot name equals to name. This is a constructor. What it will do is basically it will just set the values of these two variables, whatever is getting passed into it. Okay, now what we'll do is let's make two objects of a student. So I will say student. A student S1 equals to new student, and I need to pass roll number as 1 and name as to be Hadoop. Let me copy this and create one more object. I am pointing this time. I am going to use variable 2 just to point the object. Now, these two objects seems identical, right? Now, if I say S1 dot, or there is a way to compare it, right? So, if I say sysO, and I want to get S1 double equals S2. So, we are actually comparing the two objects and try to get its whether it is true or false. I mean, this operation, this is actually the comparison between two. Okay, if it would have been only single equal to, it is the assignment. It means that whatever is the right side value will be assigned to the left one. So if this is something, it will be assigned to S1. Okay, but we are using double equal to is a comparison operator in Java. Okay, it will try to compare the values of both of the variables and try to give whether it is equal or not. If it is equal, it is true. If it is not equal, it is false. Okay, so it should print either true or false. Now, I am asking you one question. What it should print? This is because we are seeing that these two student objects are identical. And each one are getting 0.2. Each one of them are getting... So there are two different objects in the heap. This is the first object. okay, and s1 variable is pointing to it. This is second object, and s2 variable is pointing to it. Now we are comparing s1 and s2 whether they are pointing to identical objects or not. So what is your thought, whether we will get true or false? True means they are equal, false means they are not equal. Any guess? Sorry?
False.
How come?
It's two different objects, right?
Yeah, but they
refer to a different stack.
No, but then if you see, there are like identical objects, right? Though they are two, we are comparing the objects whether they are equal or not. Okay, let me run it. Oh, sorry, no. So it is false. You are correct, it is false. But the reason behind it is that, again, it is not an object-oriented concept again, okay? So here we are seeing one more non-object-oriented concept of Java, okay? And instead of checking whether the object is real or really equal or not, by default checks the referential equality, whether these both references are equal or not, right? Now let me just try to make it clear. Okay, so we have two objects, right? Student 1 and student 2. So let's say S1 and S2. And there is one student object over here and one student object here. So this is one Hadoop. This is also one Hadoop. It is pointing to this, it is pointing to this, right? Though these objects are really equal. I mean, they both are said to be equal only because they have the two values. The state of both the objects are identical. Okay, they are the instance of class, they are the instance of class student, and the state is also identical, right? So they are completely identical, but they both are being pointed by different variables, S1 and S2. So instead of checking whether these are equal, Java is checking whether these are equal. So this S1, let's say, point to 100x, and this S2 is pointed, let's say, 200x in the memory location. So it is trying to check whether 100x equal to 200x. This is never possible, right? That is what is called referential equality check, not the object equality check. Though the object is really equal, if you see this one comma Hadoop, one comma Hadoop, they are equal. It should actually return true. Okay, so by default the behavior of the Java is non-object oriented. That in terms of that, if you try to check if the both the objects are equal or not, instead of checking whether the object is equal or not, objects are equal or not, it is trying to check whether the references pointing to them are equal or not. Okay, now if I say somehow that after doing this I will just S1 equals to S2, okay, then basically it will tell yes. Okay, if I now run this, I will tell you what we have done. If I run yes, it will say true. So what we have done in this case, we have just say S1 equals to S2 means S1 is now started pointing to S2 and they both are now in 200x. Are you getting me? So 200x equal to 200x, and that's why actually it is giving us the true value or true result out of it.
It's assignment, right?
Yeah,
S2 assignment. Is assigned to S1.
Yes, that is assignment. This is, we have just reassigned. Or this is the assignment. This is the assignment. And now they both are pointing to the same object, and that's why it becomes true. Even though it is a referential check. Any question?
Here actually the S1 points to S2. S2 point to S1. Hold on, I'm just confused here.
Oh, sorry. am I wrong? S1 equals to, we are actually giving the value of S2 to S1. So yes, so S2 value is 200x, so we are giving at S2 S1 also, and S1 also is now pointing 200x in the memory location. So yes, this is correct. Don't get confused.
Okay, got it.
Got it? So we are, whatever is S2 is having, we are actually making, we are also assigning it to S1. So S1 is also now pointing to 200x. So this is how it is, okay, S1 equals to S2. So now the problem is Java on its core is not an object oriented. Though it is being advertised as object oriented, but we have seen several things that tells that Java is not a complete object oriented. One is static, one is primitive data type. The third one is also we have discussed about kind of the uniform access principle, and this is now fourth one that it is not doing object equality check, it is actually doing the referential equality check. Okay, that is not something object oriented. Now if we really want to make this happen, so I'm just removing this assignment operator and I want this to make it, you know, real, we know that this is equal, we should print it true. What should we do for that? For that, what we need to do is basically there is one equals method that we need to override. So if I say equal, okay, there is equals method that is coming from the boss, who is the boss of Java, it's object. So there is object class in which this equals method is defined. Open declaration of this equals method, not coming. So open declaration of object, sorry. And there is something called equals method. Okay, so if you see public boolean equals, we are passing object to it and it will just compare that object. Okay, there is one more overloaded, might be no, only that one. Okay, so this is coming from object. Now what we are going to do here is we are actually passing the typeset. Let me close it. Boxing is also done. Teacher example done. We are working with a student. So what we need to verify is basically we need to, you know, return this to true, because it will return a boolean. Okay, and that's what actually being called over here. When you say double equal to, it just now set to say equals, and we need to pass s2 over here. So this is the other way of writing the comparison between two objects. Okay, so if I just remove this, it will again still make you false. Why? Because even the equals method in object is implemented in such a way that it will again compare the references only, not the actual objects. Okay, so what we need to do is I will say equals, we need to override that method and make some changes over here. So return super, but I am not going to do this. I am going to compare this, really the objects, not the references. So we are in one student's object instance over here. So let's say if I say s1.s2, so we are here in s1. Okay, so this will be treated as this, and this will be treated as the passed object to it. So that is this one obj, this obj. Okay, just try to understand, this is very important. Okay, so what I will do is first time I will check if the instance of my objects, object is it should be the instance of the student object first. So we need to first check whether it is a object is instance of this is the instance of a student, first of all. Okay, whatever we are passing over here. Okay, so this is going to be what, so we are trying to understand this thing. Okay, if this equals method gets called on this s1, okay, we should return this particular, I mean, we expect this overall, you know, comparison to result in a true, and it actually should compare the object, you know, instead of comparing its references. Okay. So that's what we are trying to deal with over here. So we are now overriding equals method and try to implement in such a way that instead of comparing the reference, whether it should actually compare the object itself. Okay. So what we do have in object, we do have two states. One is the roll number and the other one is the name. Okay. So it should compare the state of an object, whether they are equal or not. If the state of an object are equal, basically it should return true, else false. So first thing that we need to check is if this object, whatever we are passing over here, should be the instance of a student or not. If not, then definitely, if yes, then it should do this, else return false. Right, so this is perfectly all right. Now within this we need to check if it is really instance of object or instance of student, then we need to compare the student state of these both objects. So we need to now say return this dot roll number equals obj dot roll number. Okay, we need to first cast it, then only we can use it. Okay, so because this is just holding the pointer to that student object, but it does not know where what it actually points to. So if this is that, then we need to cast it. So I will say student other equals, and I will just cast this student into it. Okay, and instead of using obj, I will just use other over here and then compare the things. So it should get roll number now.
I could not understand
this. Yeah, let me just complete and I will let you understand. So this dot name equals other dot name. Now let's understand this, right? So we are here actually. So this is what will happen when we actually start executing this. So S1 is pointing to this one, right? This is the first instance of a student object, and S2 is pointing to the second student's instance, right? Now I'm trying to compare S1 equals S2 or not, and equals is the method coming from your object, that is the top class. Again, we are now overriding its behavior over here. Now what we are doing is, when equals getting passed by this object reference, that is this one, okay, we are passing over here, S2 is coming over here. So first thing we need to check is whatever we are getting over here is the instance of student object or not. Okay, instance of means it will check whether it is this student object is coming from a student class. I mean, it is the copy or it's like the production of the student class or not. If it is not at all, if I pass some building or some bridge or some other object, so it's anyway cannot be comparable, right? So you cannot compare one human and one animal, right? Or you cannot compare one bridge and river, something like that, right? So you can compare two bridges if the length, width and breadth, everything is equal or not. So we are talking here to the comparison of two objects of same domain, basically. So yes, basically we will first check whether the instance that we are dealing with is the instance of student object or not. If it is not, it means it is not going to be executed, and by default you will get a false result out of this check. Are you getting me? If it is true that this object is the instance of a student object, then this check will be there. So first thing we need to convert, or we need to cast, because the thing is this object is a generic variable. I mean, it does not know which objects it is pointing to. So we need to cast it back to the student one. Okay, we need to tell that this object is actually pointing to the student one. So we have created one temporary variable over here that is of type student, and whatever this object is pointing to, we are casting it back to the student object. Okay, now this other will actually point to a student one. Okay, so now we do have two variables. One is this that is pointing to the this particular student object, and another one is other that is pointing to this this object, sorry, this student object. So I will say obj or other over here. Okay, and now we need to compare one by one. So this dot roll number, it means that the first object, I mean s1 dot roll number equal to s2 dot roll number, that is what I am trying to get it here, or s1 dot name is equals to s2 dot name. If they both are equal, okay, if this and this, they both are returning true, then return, so this will actually return true. It will automatically return true, basically. This is the way that, because again, this return will evaluate this particular statement, and this statement will return either a true or false. Because why? This will either return a true or false, this will either return a true or false, and combined result will either true or false. Okay, because we have seen that when we say double equals to only, it will either return or true or false, right? So this is that operator. Let me just save this and now compare this one and run it. And it is returning true. Suppose if I made the change in name over here, so I know that Hadoop is not equal to Hadoop name, and it should return me a false. And yes, it is working perfectly. Are you getting me? This is how you can compare two different objects on the object equality check basis, not on the referential check equality basis. Are you getting me? So this is how you can convert equals method, how you implement equals method, so that instead of comparing the referential equality check, it should compare the object equality check. Very important concept. Very. Okay. If you understand that how it has worked or it is working, basically it will, you know, remove a lot of confusions, you know, and it makes a lot of clarity in your mind.